Hello, my friend. Today, we're going to talk about how to live off your trading profits, how to make $100,000 a year with a relatively small account. This gives you financial freedom. Financial freedom is a powerful idea. It allows you to have the freedom to move anywhere in the world that you want to live in. You don't have to live where the climate is bad or where it's too hot. You know, you have the freedom to devote the time to what you really want. You can, spend less time working and more time traveling or with family and friends, or working at something that you enjoy instead of something that makes you the most money. You know, I mean, financial freedom is really what allows you to put food on the table, because the bills don't stop, you know, they just keep going. And the way to do it when trading is to hit singles. You know, don't swing for the fences, just make a little bit of money every month, and then it's better than just waiting for a big payoff. So if you want to be a part of it, of this, please stay on. You know, what really motivates me is when people tell me that my video has changed their lives. You know, it jacks me up. It motivates me to continue. You know, when somebody tells me that in the comments that they learned something new from my video, that it was useful, that helps them, you know, that actually improves their trading or their investment knowledge going forward, that's the best way that they can support me is by making those comments, you know, and of course to subscribe. And, you know, if you want to smash the like button or bang it, like some people say, bang the like button, that is also very helpful. So I'll tell you my case. For if you have watched my channel, you know that I am partial for longer dated options. You know, some people sell calls for one month, and they sell a chain of them. After that month expires, they sell another one and another one and another one. Hopefully they all expire worthless and they get to keep the premium.
Connection loss.
But, you know, I prefer to sell calls that are, you know, 12 months into the future, or sell puts 12 months into the future. And I'll tell you why. It's because, you know, when you do a 1 month option string, for example, in covered calls, you might get a yield in 12 months after selling 12 of them for about 15% of the original notional amount of the underlying. But, you know, if you sell a 1 month, a one time 12 month put, you might get 10%, you know? And so what happens? That's about a 5 percentage point different, which is material. But, you know, what happens if the price starts going up? Then you begin to have to write the at the money puts at a higher strike price. And then you're exposing yourself to a reversal and a loss. The same thing happens when you do covered calls. What happens if the price drops? Are you going to start writing calls at the lower price? You know, that's going to be tough, because then you're going to have to give up your underlying at a low price. You know, you don't want to do that. What you want is to lock in that value. If you sell cover calls and you sell them for 12 months, you get 10%. You know, that's not bad. And if the price drops in the interim, then you just hold it. And within a year, price are likely to recover. The same thing with writing puts. If you sell a put and the price takes off, then you're done. You know, that put is not going to be challenged. You know, so this is not a static strategy. You have to remember that you have to manage and roll the losers, and you have to roll your options smartly. You have to pick the right strike prices. You have to pick the right expirations. So how do you react to the price movements of the underlying is key here. It's not about panicking, you know, it's not about buying high or selling low. you know, what you want to do is you want to put the odds in your favor, so that you have like sort of the wind in your back if you're a sailor. You know, eventually you will get paid handsomely for doing for selling puts or for selling covered calls. So you know, if the price goes up, then you do this. If the price goes down, you do that. You know, you have a plan at least. So if the price is moving in your favor, does that mean that you're right? I mean, is it confirmation? You know, if the price moves against you, does that mean that you're wrong or that you're early? You might be down for a reason, you know? So when you're trading stocks, you know, the value is supported by the earnings, and the earnings rise over time with the growth of the economy. You're participating in the growth of the economy when you have like an index fund, like the S&P 500, the ETF, SPY, you have a broad participation in the economy. All the economic sectors are integrated into the S&P 500. So it's true, there might be some short-term volatility, you know, for a number of reasons, you know, the pandemic, geopolitical things, the weather, hurricane, earthquakes, you know, any number of things can be hurtful for prices. You know, inflation, interest rates going up or down, you know, you never know. But in the long term, you can be certain. I mean, this is a no-brainer. In the long term, in 10, 15, 20 years, stock prices are going to be higher because all these short-term problems get worked out. But in the short term, you know, problems can happen. You know, the issue I have with Bitcoin and gold and collectibles and all of those types of earnings, that investments that don't have any earnings, is that you don't have any way of measuring what they're worth. You know, you depend on another investor willing to pay more coming after you, because they're gonna buy higher from you because they think there's someone else that's gonna come behind them to pay even more. So that's a classical definition of what speculation is. You know, you just buy because you think somebody else is gonna pay more later, or you buy because you think the price is going to go up. You know, when you have farm, you know, the crop, there's a crop yield, you know, you grow stuff there. When you have real estate, there's rents go up, the price of the real estate is supposed to go up as well. If you have stocks and the corporate profits go up, you know, the stocks are worth more. You know, that's easy to understand. Now with Bitcoin, gold, collectibles, it's not so easy. So when you buy stocks or you buy options or you sell them, there's any number of trade or market orders that you can put. The market order is what I usually do. You know, market order has the advantage that it gets immediately executed. And that's exactly what I want. I want to get it done. And the disadvantage is that perhaps the price could have been a little bit better if you use a limit order. A market order is an order that gets executed at the going price. Traders have bid ask prices. And if you're buying and you put a market order, you're going to have to pay the ask price. So that's a higher. The bid is lower and the ask is higher, and that's what the traders make. So if you're selling a call option, for example, you're going to have to hit the bid. So you put the market order and it gets sold at the bid. If you want to improve this a little bit, you could use a limit order, and then you need to have pay for timely order information, the price information, which is expensive. It's about $20 a month. Why would you pay for this? I mean, if you have there, you know, the bid and the ask exactly at the time that you're doing the order, and you put it right in the middle to say what, you know, maybe your order doesn't get executed. you know, maybe prices move, you know, very quickly. So what are you going to save in 100 shares? You know, really, I mean, you would put limit orders if you're trading like, you know, a lot of shares, but not for 100 shares. You know, I just usually use market orders when I trade my options, or when I trade my ETFs, my SPY or my QQQs. And then there are the stop loss orders. Stop loss orders are actually limit orders that are, if you are selling a limit order below market, it will be classified as a stop loss order. And why would you do this? You know, I made a video on why stop loss orders can burn you. And the reason is you normally do this, people say, as portfolio insurance. You know, if in case prices starts coming down, then your portfolio gets sold out, and then you're all in cash. But then, you know, what do? You put your stop loss orders like 5% below the market or 10% below. If you put it 10% below the current prices, and the prices loss come down, you know, at 10%, your stop market loss is going to become a market order at that time, and then it gets executed. But then what happens? You're selling on the dip, and that's precisely the time that you're supposed to buy, you know? So it doesn't make any sense. You should buy the dip, not sell it. And that's what you're doing with a stop loss order. So I don't usually use any of those. So I tell you, fear is more powerful than greed, or the fear of missing out, you know, because the fear of missing out, the greed, is going to make you buy high. When prices start going up and you say, I'm not there, I have to buy, you're going to overpay. When market prices are coming down and you see, I'm losing money, I don't want to lose any more, I don't want to lose it all. So you have fear, and then you sell, you end up selling low. So try to avoid emotion. That's one thing. When people do paper trading to sort of you know, try to understand it, they think it's easy. You know, it seems easy because you don't have anything at stake, so you don't have any fear, and you don't have any greed because, you know, you're just learning. But trading in real life is very different than paper trading. So I tell you, my channel is about financial education. I'll tell you what I think, what I do, you know, so that you learn, you know, and if you disagree, you can drop me a comment. Maybe, you know, I learn every day in YouTube, you know, from other contributors and other people that watch my videos. Sometimes, you know, are things that I haven't looked at in one particular way. And you know, incremental knowledge is always good. You may know the basics, but then some people might help you see things differently. So, you know, obviously I'm not giving you any advice. You know, when investing, there is risk. You can lose money. I wish you the best, my friend. Be well.